Welcome to Jung Tuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in physics in relation to climate research over the past century. I'm so glad many viewers have made their comments on my previous talks about the zero surface radiation hypothesis, although some were blocked by the man-made CO2. Today, I'd like to share with you the long process over the past several months, how I came to reach the conclusion, namely the condensed matter part of the surface of this planet cannot be treated as a radiation source, as far as the long-term and the global climate stability is concerned. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. The term transmitted surface radiation was used to denote the infrared radiation from the condensed matter surface of the Earth that could be observed at the top of the atmosphere. Also, it is called the transmitted surface irradiation. It sounds reasonable because the infrared absorbers in the atmosphere could absorb a large proportion from the infrared source, as John Tyndall first experimentally observed. In 1898, the first infrared absorption spectra for water vapor and CO2 were observed by Rubens and Aschkinas using this simple experimental setup. Notice the source is a zirconium burner. The gas is placed in the tube, and the box K represent the refractor and the detector. This is the key result. As you can see, the water vapor absorption is significantly weak, between 8 and about 40 micron, which indicates that over 90% of infrared rays can be transmitted through this window, while the rest of the wave number region is almost opaque. This is similar to those minimum dips associated with water vapor absorption in the solar radiation spectrum observed on the ground by Nanny. Although the radiation source is a remote sun separated from the Earth by vacuum. If the condensed matter surface of Earth could be treated as an isolated infrared emitter, then it seems reasonable to argue that the dip observed by Rubens and Aschkinas would be observable at the top of the atmosphere from the satellite. Indeed, that is exactly what climate researchers have assumed since 1860, when the infrared absorption by water vapor and CO2 were observed by Tyndall. Hence, the observed dip in NAP was naively called the atmospherical window through which the surface infrared irradiation can go directly to outer space. For this reason, the transmitted surface radiation has been often used as a synonym of the atmospherical window among climate researchers, despite they are conceptually different. Perhaps that's why it would appear the transmitted surface radiation is essential to cool down the Earth's surface. So when I first realized that no infrared radiation can be emitted by the surface in the presence of the massive atmosphere, I was struggling how to explain the observable outgoing long wave radiation, or OLR, above the ground or above sea level. What did I do? I listened to symphonies by Brahms, my favorite. By investigating the history, I concluded The transmitted infrared emission at the top of the atmosphere is not directly emitted by the condensed matter surface. At most, one can argue that it is the warmest air layer, called the turbulent mixed boundary layer by the meteorologists, attached to the land and the ocean. That is the infrared source, but without a well-defined upper boundary. This is not a big deal. In the absence of the so-called surface emission, the condensed matter surface would become much more stable in keeping its global mean temperature with the air. To justify my argument, I would like to use two relevant papers. One was by Kill and Trainbirth in 1997, in which the earliest global energy budget diagram was proposed. Another is by Koska and Shine in 2012, who calculated the outgoing long-wave radiation due to directly transmitted surface emission, theoretically. In the paper by Kills and Trainbirth, the transmitted surface emission is about 40 watt per meter square compared to the total OLR of 235 watt per meter square. Although the authors made it clear that their estimate is somehow ad hoc rather than the product of the detailed calculations. Interestingly enough, the authors also noted that the infrared radiation originates near the Earth's surface. Notice they used near but not from the surface. What did they mean? Clearly, they mean the air layer near the surface, nothing else. So it would appear they also thought there is no surface infrared radiation. Perhaps they also found the temperature jump or the temperature discontinuity at the surface is absurd. Who knows? But at least they had the goal to admit the incurable defect in the standard model for the climate, unlike many other climate researchers. Still, Kills and Trainbirth seemed cautious about their wording, as they then wrote, the 40 watt per meter square emphasizes that very little radiation is actually transmitted directly to space, as though the atmosphere were transparent, which implies they consider that radiation originating from the surface. So, if you don't read their paper carefully, you might have thought they thought the transmitted surface radiation is from the surface. Unfortunately, the well-crafted cover-up has been destroyed by two seemingly naive climate researchers. One, SMS Costa from Brazil, another, KP Shine from the UK. First, they pointed out Kills and Trainbirth didn't explicitly consider the surface radiation. Second, they claim they had taken both water vapor and the clouds into account. Therefore, they wrote, our method is considerably more complex than that used by Kills and Trainbirth. So what? Here is their key result. The dashed line represents the surface blackbody radiation at 288 Kelvin. The solid line denotes the OLR under the clear sky condition with a fabricated CO2 dip. And the gray area is either the atmospheric window or the directly transmitted surface emission. The reason why the transmittance within the atmospheric window is less than one was explained by so-called water vapor continuum absorption. In short, their calculated STE is 22 watt per meter square, almost half of the 40 watt per meter square estimated by Kuehl and Trendebers in 1997. Strangely, Trendebers behaved as an obedient child and immediately adopted this new value for the transmitted surface radiation in his 2012 paper, as if he had never said the infrared source is the air near the surface. Return to the second paper, although no details were provided by Costa and Shine, how they treated the temperature jump at the surface, it could be argued that they must have assumed the immediate layer above the surface is vacuum, rather than the air layer, which is as warm as the surface. Indeed, the assumption made by Arrhenius in 1896 would appear to be a time bomb at the core of the standard climate model. If you keep thinking all the possible repercussions carefully, in line with my recent talks. In summary, it is ordinary air molecules, nitrogen and oxygen, that can prevent the surface from the unnecessary radiation cooling or warming by simply being there as part of the surface of this planet. Thank you for your support, dear viewers. See you next time.